Can you hear it? Welcome to Relay.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Relay Station. I'm Nikara. That's Shiver. That's Haramis. That's the Cutlass Red. He's firing at us. How's it going?
What's going on? Everyone was frozen a minute ago, and now you're all talking. I've been sat here for half an hour, awkwardly in silence with you not moving, and now you talk. What's going on?
I have no idea what's going on.
What's going on?
Oh, hello, Stevie Madman. Thank you for joining us. My video looks weird, so I'm going to fix it.
Looks like a German flag behind you.
So, yeah, definitely not. That is a Calgary Flames blanket. Because I have a leather chair and, well, leather, and it's in the basement, so it gets cold. Anyway. Mm-hmm. So, Star Citizen is back. This is the first week where we have Inside the Verse, or Inside Star Citizen, same deal. Once again, our beautiful and freshly shaven Haramis there did the videos for us from ISC this week. So let's jump right into show and tell. That is not a video from this week's. I do everything right except for one thing, right? Oh, terrible. That is not the right video. Just.
But it looks good.
It sure does. All right, let's get the right one. There we go. There it is. So, one of the first things they told us this week on Inside Star Citizen is they will be trying to get all three moons of Microtech done in one quarter, so that they can move on to the Pyro system. So the environment artists can move on to the Pyro system specifically. Yay. They look freaking gorgeous in this video. Each one of them. Very impressed with the work they're doing. I'm glad to see them try and push themselves a little bit, because obviously they need to go faster. That's just the way it is. And, I think it would be huge for the project if they can get, like, if, the sooner they can get the Pyro system open, the better. Any thoughts from you guys on the new moons?
Shiver? I want through.
Oh, Haramis? Haramis.
I want to go through the anal thing and jump right through the anals of time into Pyro.
This is what happens when you don't plug him.
Mm-hmm. Oh my. All right, Relay Station 2020. The anus of time.
Oh yeah.
There we go.
That's real Indiana Jones shit right there. Bam.
Fair enough. Okay, what do you think about the moons though?
Look like marbles to me.
That's fair.
Yeah, can't say much about them actually. I wasn't on them, and from above they look really good. Yeah.
Hey, thank you, Carbide Edge. 26 months. Holy crap. Hey, we got Haramis in on the wiggle. In a heart. That's pretty good. You got two wiggles and a heart. Congratulations. And thank you so much. His message was "Shiver me timber." I quite like that. One of the things I thought was interesting with this topic was they talked about they were going to be using the ocean biomes more They have one moon that is mostly ocean, one that is mostly frozen ocean. So that's a big challenge because they haven't used them very much. So that's going to be interesting to see.
Didn't they have already some frozen areas?
Yep, they did, but they've only used the frozen ocean once on Microtech, and they only used the ocean part once on Hurston. Okay. So I think there's more extensive use of them here. You can actually see in the Calliope. Is there a better way to pronounce that, Shiver? I think I'm messing it up. Okay, you're muted, my friend.
Melon.
Oh, melon. Okay. The one spelled Calliope is named melon. Good to know. That'll be an inside information for anyone watching Relay Station. Hey, Mr. Squarepeg. Moving right along.
Oh, Carp by Edge says Calliope.
Calliope? Or Calliope. Calliope. All right. Our
calcium, lithium, oxygen, and P.
And now our illustrious guest, Cutlass Red, gets featured here prominently. So now we have ways to heal and respawn on ships. Yay?
Yeah.
Yay. Also, you get to have lights all over your ship and blind people, which is great.
Now, there's one problem with the Cutlass Red. It breaks the laws of physics.
There's a lot of things that break the laws of physics.
It's red, and it isn't the fastest ship.
True.
Is it the fastest Cutlass?
But
I don't even think it's the fastest Cutlass.
Oh, that's a shame.
What happens if you paint flames on it, though, then?
That'll make it go faster.
Yeah. Probably means you're damaged.
Yes. Speaking of which...
The respawn mechanic is awesome. I think that's exactly what people need.
Exactly. Speaking of flames, there's a good clip this week on Reddit from Brewbeard, user Brewbeard. This is the damage effects on the Cutlass Red. And looking pretty good.
It's fine. That'll buff out.
Yes, the pieces that aren't missing will buff out, yes.
Now think about top positions.
What was that?
I'm just thinking if it now flies against the wall and we have soft body collisions, then
yes,
the damage gasm is perfect.
Soft body collisions would make this game basically perfect. they're so hard to do though. They tend to make computers scream whenever you try and do them.
Do we have?
We lose Hermes? Hermes is frozen.
I thought it was just me having a stroke.
Well, you are having a stroke, but Hermes is also having a stroke, so. Hey, you're back! Hey, Hermes! Oh, now I fell down again.
Okay.
Now you're back.
Sorry.
Your internet had a hiccup.
Yeah.
Someone using the microwave.
Maybe. Those microwaves.
Those terrible microwaves, eh?
Mm-hmm.
So.
But I was asking, is there some previews of the tech? Did CIA...
Nothing I've seen for soft body collisions.
Okay.
I mean, you can definitely go out there and look at soft body collisions in other games. They tend to be... A lot of games don't try and do it, first of all, because it's really hard. Secondly, but there is a game I'm trying to... there's a game called Beam NG Drive, which is only a game in the loosest way of, you know, imagining. It's basically a tech demo for soft body vehicle collisions. And but it's pretty fun because things, you know, break and twist and...
Okay, what was it called?
I actually don't know. Maybe they do. I'm not sure, though. So, I also wanted to... I grabbed a couple things from Reddit from this week because, well, Reddit's not terrible. And this one was pretty great too. This is a just a cool shot from Hurston. If I can ever get it to the right size. Cooperate with me. There we go.
Ooh.
Yeah, this looked pretty good. So this one was from user Thundercorp. I just thought it was a pretty pretty great way to show off sort of where things are at. You can see the Cutlass Red there in the background.
Mm-hmm. If now the wheat would wiggle under the feet or
yes,
something like that.
Collision.
Damn, yeah.
More collision. Yeah. All right. Back to Hermes' work here.
My hard work this week was so terrible. Two videos in ISC and one video for SC Live. So
SC Live was fun this
week.
What
happened to that German efficiency, Tofu?
Not here in Sweden.
So me and Hermes, you watched SC Live, I assume?
A little bit. They talked about Star Trek a tiny bit. That I remember. But I watched a little bit on the side, I have to admit. So,
yeah, I kind of put... I mean, I watched most of it, but I put it on and did stuff. But because I had a lot of stuff to do this morning. You know,
but
housework,
looks,
yay!
But the planets look amazing now.
Mm-hmm.
It's really... I was thinking, what? Unfortunately, my capture couldn't really bring it over. But, yeah.
So this is how long is this video from SC Live? Is it like the whole?
I put it in 5 minutes, in under 5 minutes.
Nice. Well, that can run for a while. That's cool. We can talk about it. So, well, what Star Citizen Live was this week was basically showing how points of interest are created on the planets. We got to chat with or the people who were there. I mean, got to chat with environment artist. Can you remember his name, Hermes? Because my brain is totally not working right now.
No, I can't, because I generally don't remember names.
Fair enough. So
I work at a new company, and I have a lot of names to learn.
So it was...
As long as you're not personnel, it's fine.
So it was Jared, obviously, as he is there every week, and Luan Vettoretti, who is an environment artist. I'm sure that I might be murdering that name, but I tried. But he was basically showing us how he creates points of interest on the planet. One of the interesting things that came from that was that currently the artists kind of have to manually, place the interaction between the item and the world. Like, they can't snap it to the ground because it often doesn't work. And there's a whole tool that they're building right now to make that much easier, to make it more reliable, to place things on environments and have them actually place correctly on the ground. So currently they're having to adjust that, like, Z height quite a lot.
Yeah, I bet they have, because the planet is round, so...
Yep, and not only that, but the ground is very uneven. Not
yeah,
helpful.
That too, yeah.
But yeah, the planets are looking amazing. Even in this, you can see the how detailed everything is getting.
Yeah.
That
place is just awesome.
So I definitely, I would encourage people. I mean, you don't have to sit there and stare at the whole thing for an hour, but even just putting Star Citizen Live in the on the background as you do something, this was a fun one to sort of listen along and watch every once in a while. And he was talking again about how one of the things they have to adapt to when they start working on Star Citizen as environment artists is the scale, because they're like placing things and everything seems so tiny, and then they actually go to a human size and they're like, oh, everything's huge. Because you zoom out from the planets and everything's just gigantic. So, let's start collecting questions. I'm guessing the bot is not working because, well, I'm not David, so.
You're not?
Not this week, anyway.
So does that mean that we're going to have a German beer hall sing? if there's no questions.
No, it means I'm going to sing. Which is really
what
scary.
What should we do with drunken Ares? What should we do with drunken Ares? What should we do with drunken Ares early in the morning?
I like that. No? I like that. That's that. I... Shiver, did you ever play Assassin's Creed Black Flag?
No.
No? I'm assuming Haramis did because, well, that's where I got that song from.
I played 1 hour.
Sing that in school.
Also, of Black Flag.
It was my I love pirate games, and it's ironic, but pretty much the best pirate game I've ever played was Assassin's Creed Black Flag, and all the sea shanties were my favorite part. I got so many memorized in my head now. Spent many hours. So if you have any questions, ask them here.
I walked about there, so I had my Google Play Music has some shanties from Assassin's Creed Black Flag in the like list, actually.
Nice. That's awesome.
Why is your link different from mine, but they will still work?
The mysteries of Google. I actually had the same thought. I'm like, oh, my link's different. And then I clicked them both, and I'm like, oh, they both go to the same place. Oh, that's funny. Oh, man. So the other big piece of news this week, of course, is that obviously with the Cutlass Red, 3.8.1 is live. That added the Cutlass Red to the game. Also added was an entrance light ring around where the player should stand to be able to get into the mole. Apparently that was a problem. Added weapon report audio for ship weapons and atmosphere. A cooldown for player bounties of the same player. And rented ships in the persistent universe can no longer be modified. Now, with gameplay, they added the med bed, which we saw. Or actually, I don't know if we didn't really show it off, did we? But yeah, you can now... actually, was it in the Cutlass Red video? Should I go back to that?
What?
The med bed. The med bed part. Yeah. Was it in the Cutlass Red video?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go back to that.
Cutlass Red video.
Bam. All right. So yeah, the med beds, you can jump into them and then use your interaction to heal yourself. And you can also set it as a respawn point. So you can respawn, you know, when you repeatedly kill yourself trying to, you know, jump through a planet or something. Which they talked a little bit about on Star Citizen Live this week, how they really can't, because of how big their world is, they can't really... QA all of the possible ways that people can screw up their character.
Actually, Water Buffalo does bring up a very interesting point of medbed, basically ability to be spawn camped if very unlucky.
Yep. Yeah, that would really suck. That's an interesting thought, actually.
What?
Well, you could possibly be spawn camped if somebody knew that you were going to respawn in the Cutlass Red. And just kill you every time you respawn.
Well, there was someone who was just patient enough to just go, I'm going to wait here.
Yeah, right? What do you think of the design of the Cutlass Red?
Sirens. Fucking yep. Sirens. Best ship in the game ever so far.
People are totally going to go around all the time with their siren on. It's gonna be great.
Yep.
So are you going to pick up a guy to treat him? No, I'm going to get ice cream. I don't know what you're on about. But your siren's on. Yeah, and?
It's an emergency. It's ice cream. Did you not hear me?
Exactly.
Yeah. My hemorrhoids removed, and I need ice cream because my hemorrhoids got removed. And that's why the sirens are on.
Always to take that. That was not the one I thought you were going to take it.
Okay.
That's impressive, though. I like it. Oh my. So, another few things that are important here that were added to 3.8.1. They added a checkbox in the game options to disable the film grain effect, which some people despise. Like Shiver, apparently.
Fucking hate film grain.
I've
got a fucking 3440 by 1440p monitor. Why are you smearing shit on it? Get rid of your fucking bullshit. We got rid of film grain when we went over to DV fucking D's. I don't want it back.
It's artistic.
Oh, it's shit. I'm playing a game, not watching a fucking VHS.
So, they've now re-added, because this definitely used to be in there, but they've now re-added the target nearest friendly functionality and keybind. Camera shake is now a slider option in the menu as well, so if you want less camera shake. They added auto-zooming on the selected target as an option. You can default that to, or it's defaulted to off, but you can turn it on now. Added weight and instruction objectives and timer to patrol mission starts. No idea what that means. And added a separate hostility activation under accidental fire threshold for party members. I'm guessing that... Any idea what that means?
Did you shoot at me?
It means if you're in a party and you accidentally shoot someone, it's a hell of a party.
You don't necessarily become hostile? Is that the idea there?
I think you've got, like, a cooldown time. You know, you start the party. If you shoot someone within that cooldown time, it doesn't matter. Possibly.
Interesting.
Ambiguous rule wording.
Yes, exactly. Yay, and yes, they do need to wipe the database with 3.8.1. They actually put that in the patch notes so people know, which is good. Thank you, CIG. That's going to be clear, even with the continued additions to persistence that we're getting, they are going to have to wipe fairly often for the next little while, I think. Eventually, it'll become rarer, but yeah, it's 3.8.1 wipes the database.
Every time they need massive changes in the database, they're going to wipe it all, I believe. So,
you know, three wipes. Happens. One up, one down, one to polish off.
Until it blinks.
Welcome to the Relay Station, everybody. Are you having fun yet? We still don't have a single question. People better start asking questions, because I can't sing. So, yeah. Yeah. All right. Moving right along.
I mean, I know a limerick. Does that count?
No.
Oh.
Limericks are not singing.
A young lady from Venus whose body was shaped like... Were you saying something?
No, I was... Go ahead.
I don't know, I've never heard the end of it. And yes, I believe so, for Lost Dan, everyone is watching the Daymar Rally.
Yeah, oh,
they've
totally.
Got a lot of viewers, they're doing well.
Totally. And the Daymar Rally is awesome. So I don't blame anybody for watching the Daymar Rally.
Bicycle.
Oh, man. So, the other thing I wanted to go... Did we get anything significant on the roadmap this week? I know there was an update, but...
That was it actually moved, as I understand it.
Oh my god. I am stunned.
What?
Oh my god. Okay, huge change this to the roadmap. All right, I'll put this up on the screen, and we'll take a look at it.
I love you, Carbide.
Uh-oh, am I in trouble? Did I do something bad? Mm-hmm. I don't know. I'm not sure what Carbide said because I'm working on this.
He said bicycle. That's two cycles in Japan, I think.
All right. So is that zoomed in enough for you guys?
Ooh, that's big.
Yeah, it's really
3.81. 40% to 100%.
40% increase to 100% from last week. Boop. All right.
What happened here?
So, a lot, apparently. Oh, my God. Jake's going to throw a freaking riot. The Prowler's no longer coming in 3.8. 3.8.3, I guess it would have been. The Carrick is still on for February, although with the Prowler being moved out of March, don't be super shocked if the Carrick gets pushed back to March.
There's some dude on Reddit who was very excited about the Carrick and doing a countdown to it. Every time I see it, I'm like, it's a gorgeous ship, but I think you're going to be disappointed, mate.
The Carrick will eventually be amazing, but a lot of the stuff that it's supposed to do, it can't do yet.
So,
like, it, because it's not in the game.
I mean, like, the Reclaimer is, it's just, right now, it's a massive ship.
It's just a massive ship. Yeah.
When do we have jump point search mechanics?
When
we have a jump point.
Once we get a jump point, yeah, that'd be the one.
We have scanning already, but yeah.
All right, so
I don't
scanning. We don't have, you know, proper scanning. I mean, we have scanning. Scanning.
And so what's changed here?
CIG would make some sort of announcement that there is something to find with a Carrick before that happens.
You'd hope.
Yeah.
Under AI, FPS combat weapon types was moved to 4.0. Cover usage V1 was moved to 4.0. Ship AI 3D navigation collision avoidance was added. And ship AI 3D pathfinding planet side was added. And NPC improvements to civilian were... It was basically just removed from the schedule. This is part of the giant rework that they do at the start of every year to figure out what they're going to do for the year. This is step two of that. So under gameplay, we got player interaction system improvements, new targeting methodology, and high-speed combat. I don't know what high-speed combat is. What the hell?
Probably combat in Quantum.
Oh my god. Please no. It's like fighting at warp in Star Citizen. Or in Star Trek, I mean.
Interesting. But you don't you reduce speed at moment when you fight with other people? So
right, it's 3.9. Duh. What does high speed combat mean? Ship systems will suffer the consequences of traveling at high speed, restricting some of the options that players will have at maximum velocity, creating a vulnerability that will push players into engagement at lower speeds. So, high-speed combat actually means they're going to push to keep players from going faster. That's an interesting way to title it.
Yeah, it's a good and most likely needed idea, but I don't engage so much in combat nowadays.
Yeah, neither do I. Dun, 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 dun.
Well, sometimes you don't have a choice.
This is also true. Law System V2, you can now surrender, apparently, as of 3.9. Yay. prison missions are being added. Unfortunately, the dynamic mission system stuff has all been removed. Commodity transfer timers accounting app, all that stuff was tied together. Death animation improvements, we can't die any prettier until 4.0. Repair, refuel, restock kiosks have just been ripped right out. So, bye. However, PvP bounties and bounty NPC improvements are done, which is nice. Asperia Prowler got moved into 3.9. And the Cutlass Blue rework is gone. Poof, gone. All of the weapons that were coming in 3.9 were moved to 4.0. And apparently we don't get better doors either. That's been removed. Weather locomotion. What is weather locomotion? Let's go look that up. Weather locomotion.
Weather that crosses across biomes? Oh, hey, Miami.
Whoa.
Weather locomotion. Where is it? There it is.
So we have a storm which goes.
The player and other characters will show improvements in locomotion when moving in inclement weather. Ah, yeah, so that's the, like, having your hand up in front of your face and struggling against the wind and stuff like that.
Okay.
Because, you know, this far in the future, they've lost the technology to make umbrellas.
I don't think we really want to have umbrellas in Star Citizen. Just lose them.
That is the least English thing you've ever said.
I bet we made eye umbrellas and they became two eye, so too intelligent, so that in the end we abandoned them. And yeah.
There is a war of...
I hear an umbrella war. Set Mars on fire.
Was a disaster.
All right, I need to show something on stream here. I'm working on finding it. Just give me a moment here. So, for 4.0, obviously FPS combat weapon types and cover usage moved from 3.9, but ship AI, atmospheric combat, ship flight AI, improvements in polishing, FPS combat, that was all removed. Or FPS combat improvements and polishing was removed. See, this one's been popping up and like it shows up every once in a while in the schedule and then gets moved. Quantum travel linking for AI ships. That'd be interesting to see if that makes it. Body dragging, again, it's been talked about for years and hasn't been actually put in. Ship HUD rework, that'll be, you know, nice to see as well.
Oh. Is body dragging the ability to change, say you've got a dead male body in front of you. Is body dragging the ability to dress that up as a dead woman?
Yes.
And vice versa?
Yep.
I love that idea. Oh, perfect.
You're silly.
Yeah, you have to do something before you, teabag your opponent.
Another one that's been jumping in and out of the schedule for years, zero-G push and pull is once again removed and pushed further. Hopefully it gets pulled at some point. Multi-crew stuff was all, again, been in the schedule for years, again removed. And NPC healing has been removed. Death animation improvements, obviously, so we can die prettier, are now in 4.0.
I mean, I get a lot of the impressions I get are they're like, well, we want to do this, and then they think to themselves, well, before we do that, we need to put in this, and we could put in this, and we need to put in this, and we need to put, oh shit, now it's spiraling out of control again, and then we can put this in.
Yes.
But it's one of those, it's more realizations of, oh yeah, fuck, we do need this, then we can go for this. Mm-hmm. We need to get to B before we can go to C.
Oh, definitely. That's definitely what you're seeing on the schedule. It's, they're like, we want to do this, and then they realize, yeah, we got to do 45 other things first. Then we can get there.
I want asteroids. Better asteroids.
I thought you said you got rid of your hemorrhoids.
Yeah. I said that to get ice cream.
Oh, okay. Well.
And to turn to sirens on, you know.
Fair enough. What else do we got here? So all those guns that were supposed to be in 3.9 are now in 4.0. And the grenade launcher has been removed. I think that is honestly the worst thing on this entire schedule. Damn it. We need our grenade launcher. Hello, Dakiko.
See, look how young he is now.
Oh, what happened? I don't know what happened.
That was awesome.
Why you?
Oh, that was awesome. All right.
Arigato.
All right. So, I have to do this just because I did figure out once and for all what happened to the umbrellas in Star Citizen. They did this, and then so we got rid of them.
Ah, yeah. That thing I was thinking about, yeah.
You saw that this week too, hey? That's an excellent bit of animation, by the way.
There's a guy who makes quite some of them, I believe.
So there you go. There's your answer, Shiver. That's what became of umbrellas in Star Citizen. They all turned into that, and we stopped using them.
All my questions are asked. If only we had people from the audience asking questions too.
Yeah, that's not going to happen. Please ask questions. That would be lovely.
They are betting on Daymar already teams, most likely.
Very likely, yes. Oh my. So let's take a look at the squadron schedule. I will eventually get that up once I stop fiddling around in OBS. My fiddling will go on for a while, I'm sure. So, obviously, we're seeing the results of a bunch of meetings that happen at the beginning of every year at CIG to sort of realign the schedule to what they think they can get done. And then coming weeks here, you'll see 4.1 and 4.2 show up in the schedule. Probably not too long from now. So, squadron schedule is right here. Once again, gigantified.
I've heard 10 of it. 10 ask a developer or something. 10? What was it? Calling all the devs comes back.
Oh, yes. Calling all devs. Yeah. It is coming back. Making its return, hopefully soon.
Yeah. For me, a reason to resubscribe, maybe.
Maybe.
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe. I'm a little bit dissatisfied that they reduced their content so much. But on the other hand, I'm getting used to what we have now, and getting 10 of Calling All Deaths back, that wasn't a good show, so I may resubscribe. So
Fair enough.
That's a reason.
That's
development.
As you can see by this schedule, especially the part on the left with the chapters, we've talked about this before many times. They're significantly behind on the schedule for chapters. They're still working on stuff that was supposed to be done in Q2 2019. So they're basically probably going to be a year behind pretty soon. That's not a big surprise. That's the way she goes with the game development sometimes. Hell, just look at what just happened to a whole fleet of games that just got delayed, including Cyberpunk by about, 5 months? Got delayed? And it's almost done, so.
Oh, did you hear that rumor? And I want to stress again, rumor, not confirmation, just
rumor,
just gossip. That they've delayed Cyberpunk because of the limitation of current gen consoles.
Yes, I did. Probably just 6 months of optimization that they need to get them to run on those consoles.
Heaven forbid you bring it out on the PC first and then be like,
I was thinking the same thing. I'm like, you could have just released it on PC and like, and Xbox One X and PS4 Pro and then release the others later, but
And then the console people will be like, oh, why is it on PC first? And PC be like, yeah, remember the good old days when that used to happen? Now you know what it feels like.
All right, so not much to see in the Squadron roadmap. A few things, you know, there really isn't much that has changed, except that FPS cover usage and combat types that we saw in the Star Citizen one have been moved back a bit. So,
I did read something in some Discord about Squadron 42 beta in some September. I don't know which September though. Where was it? I think it was on Shiver's Discord. Huh? Was it?
Are you
don't
holding
talk
out
about
on this Shiver?
Discord out loud.
The first rule of Shiver's Discord is never talk about Shiver's Discord.
You have a Discord?
A rule even Fastcart sticks to. That's how strong you know that rule is.
Okay.
A total aside, I asked Fastcart if, because now that I'm in Japan, if he now assumes that I'm a rice cracker.
Oh, nice.
Mm.
That's yeah, I like it. So
crack some rice.
The only question we have is discuss Star Trek Picard.
Who asked that?
Apparently
genius,
some
genius, handsome fellow.
Apparently some guy named Shiv - tofu.
Ah.
Interesting. So, can you discuss Star Trek Picard without giving any spoilers whatsoever?
Yes.
Okay, go.
Okay, so it's not one of the whole grim, dark things. Like, you know, Star Trek Discovery, the first 15 minutes, you were like, oh, this is pretty grim, dark. It's quite interesting. They've changed some they've made some significant changes to the universe without drastic changes to Star Trek, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of how Star Trek Deep Space Nine approached the Klingon War. You know, it's very interesting. I guessed who one of the characters was months in advance, and I stopped watching trailers after that because it turned out I was fucking right. And it was just really good to see Captain Picard again. You know, I Star Trek means a lot to me, so mm-hmm. I nearly cried through several times through the episode. Brilliant, really good.
How was Starfleet?
Spoilers.
Yeah, I can't even answer. That's what I thought. Oh, my. A reminder to anybody out there who's forgotten. If you want to have see at least some justification for why they move things around, go check out the roadmap roundup. On CIG's website, it's right here for this week. I will dump that into chat.
Carbide Edge, I'm sorry, mate, asked, have you guys read the latest CIG versus Crytek responses?
I actually didn't even hear anything about it. Go for it, man.
Crytek said, we don't want to give up. We want to sue you. Please let us sue you. We have a right to sue you.
Okay.
Which, you know, predictable. As is CIG's response earlier of, we don't want to be sued.
Yeah. But, yeah. It's... Oh. The merit of this suing from Crytek was so pointless in the first place. I watched this lawyer on YouTube who put out the tweet and where Stan, oh yeah, by the way, Amazon license also, and was like, what? Bam. I just got flashed how stupid all the whole thing was. In the end, it's maybe publicity for CIG, but what do we learn from this? Nothing.
Nope.
I think we learn that the people who are doing the lawsuit, the suits at Crytek, are very different from the people who are actually working at Crytek and doing the actual work.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Crytek has...
So the one of the ones... for anybody who wants to see that YouTuber and watch him sort of talk about this, that is Leonard French.
Yeah.
On YouTube. This is his channel right here. I will link that.
I believe he's been on this Star Citizen channel named The Base. Yeah.
I've never heard of The Base before in my life. What is The Base all about?
Well, The Base Radio, also known as TheBase.sc, not to be confused with another group called The Base, which we don't want to talk about, are a Star Citizen-themed radio station. They're also broadcasting right now on Twitch. And you know what they're broadcasting on Twitch right now? This fucking show. Hello, five people on The Base Radio that I should probably tune into and see if they have any questions. But hi. Oh yeah, I could probably stream the video to The Base Radio now that I
now you could permission and all sorts.
Yeah, if you're watching this and you don't know about The Base Radio, go check out The Base Radio.
Yeah, it's pretty great. It's pretty great. Occasionally you'll even see Shiver on there.
Yeah, I've got to sort that out again, actually. I miss doing Dead Air.
I can imagine. Yeah.
The ones of people miss doing Dead Air is me.
Hey, I understand. Hey, actually, I gotta give thanks. Thanks everybody for tuning in to watch me. There are actually quite a few people tuned in to watch my stream for the in-flight abort test, which happened last week for SpaceX.
And, did something
explode? Oh yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Things exploded when they're supposed to explode, which was great.
Okay.
It's always fine when things explode and they're supposed to explode. We're good with that.
Good that you remind me, so I can maybe watch it later.
Yeah.
Tomorrow or something. Yeah.
But yeah, so that was I did that last Saturday, right before the stream, actually. Thank you everybody for tuning in. There were like 30 something people there, and it was very early in the morning on a Saturday morning. So thank you very much. So we have no more questions. I may be forced to sing here in short order. I apologize to everybody.
Quick, think of a copyright-free song that we can sing.
There aren't any. Can't even sing that happy birthday song.
I thought they removed the copyright on that.
Maybe they have now, but it's a great moment of Star Citizen history when we got the stream pulled down for because they sang happy birthday.
There's that great episode of The Simpsons, really old episode of The Simpsons, where I think it's Bart's birthday, and they come into this awkward moment where, you know, we're going to sing happy birthday for you. It's your birthday. It's your birthday. No one else's but your birthday.
Oh, that's great. And they should have flashed the thing on the screen. Legally, we can't sing the real happy birthday song.
Oh, I think it was two French women that originally wrote it as well.
Really?
I think so.
Well, their song has become incredibly successful. Oh, man. All right. Anything else wants to talk about in Star Citizen Land?
I was before Christmas, I hopped in very, very shortly for 1.5 hours.
Oh, that's awesome.
And they put in the VoIP system. So, and I was running around Levski.
Mm-hmm.
And I always, when I ran around, I heard some or something. I was thinking, here's somewhere an NPC or something. CIJ hit something, and I have to find the NPC who gives me a mission or something. And I run around, wondering where the sound comes from. And I didn't know that a guy with VoIP also just put in some.
Oh, that's awesome.
When I found out that this was this guy, and we talked a little bit, first on English, then I recognized he was German, then I talked German to him as well. Then he told me I'm on a stream now. So
awesome.
Yeah, from Halt die Fresse Mann Gaming. It's, yeah.
It's easy for you to say.
Yeah. Why? I don't know.
Gesundheit.
Hachi. Yeah.
Chopsticks.
He talked quite a bit, and I ran around in the elevator, went down, and so forth, and the VoIP system is awesome, I have to say. It really... The volume decreases over long distances, though when I was there, I don't know if it's still the same. It was quite loud when I went 20 meters away or something. So I can definitely hear people over some distance.
That's really cool.
We got a question! We got a real question! A real person!
Oh my god! Guns and Glue asks, since you can now spawn in Cutlass Reds, how well will they sell during the sale, and how much will everyone go grief mad with it? Okay, can you explain to me how you can grief with the Cutlass Red?
Make your ship available for people to spawn on. Sit there. Wait. Hi! Welcome back to life! Bam!
I guess, but the person would actually have to, like, go into the ship and lay down on the bed and say, I want to spawn here. And then you turn on them, I guess?
What is if a ship is in a mystic zone?
In a mystic zone, eh? Maybe somebody in chat can explain to me how the Cutlass Red can be used effectively for griefing.
Actually, I find the gameplay pretty interesting. Let's expect that there you have a team of 20 people and 2 Cutlass Reds, and you want to raid a base. So 20 people all onto the base, dying in first wave, all respawning on the Reds and running again, so the base most best target is
Cutlet. The first thing that came to my head was, you know, someone doing a Michael Caine impression. Star citizens. Thousands of them.
They're everywhere. Yeah, I guess that is one aspect of it. You'd be much easier to actually mobilize a force of guys in a battle. Because they don't have, when they die, they don't have to respawn at the frickin' station. They can respawn, like, right beside the battle.
The first people who want to buy a Cutlass are organization type players. So
4 kilometers is about 4,000 meters, Miami.
So yeah. In terms of how well it'll sell, I mean, it's been for sale many times before. It'll probably sell pretty well, though. One of the interesting things that I just read is that the 890 jump and the Carrick both have med beds as well, so they'll also be spawn points. So obviously the 890 jump is in already. The Carrick will be coming in very soon. I mean, depends if they keep their promise with February or not. But I don't think I think it might get delayed to March. But yeah. Regardless, it'll be in soon. So I should also mention there is a Lunar New Year sale right now that's happening, and the three ships that are currently for sale are the Origin M50 because it's red, the A90 Jump, and the Anvil Carrick. So if you're, you know, been chomping at the bit to get any of those ships, go and grab them. Also, red envelopes have been hidden around the major hubs throughout the verse, and so you can go and collect them and sell them at kiosks and get tons of money. So enjoy. Happy hunting.
What envelopes?
Red envelopes red. Have been hidden. Here, I'll show you the red envelopes. Mm-hmm. Might as well give me something to do, right? Red envelopes. Yay. Wait, what?
This is what happens when we don't have Eris to sing.
Exactly.
Or threatening to sing.
Exactly. So, I gotta say, the file name for this image is called Microsoft Teams. I don't really know why. Explain, CIG. So, this is the image, right? It'd be nice if I actually could find it.
What if... No. I had the craziest of thoughts.
Was that?
What if Star Citizen or Squadron is going to be available on the Windows Store?
It might be. I mean, to the point where I think it might be available on lots of things when it comes out. So this image is called Microsoft Teams Image 31. I got nothing. But these are the red envelopes that you can find scattered around right now that will give you money if you sell them at kiosks. So go find them. Invade the verse with your Cutlass Red. Also, I love the textures in new games. Textures took a long time to come along very well in games. For a long time, they were just awful. Even in games that looked all right, you look at the texture and you're like, oh. It's terrible.
Yeah.
So the texture on those envelopes that's impressive. It really is.
Mm-hmm. But going back to the public source, I would like Steam to have Star Citizen someday.
Mm-hmm.
So also, but not Microsoft Store, don't care. So okay.
I can see
it going on GOG, maybe.
I can see it going on almost anything, and it'll just be a launcher. It'll just launch the...
Yeah.
And it will...
I don't want it on Epic, though, just because I hate Epic nowadays.
Epic. You're in the I Despise Epic group?
Oh, yeah. I'm in the I Hate Epic so tremendously group, because...
I don't think it's...
going. Mean on Linux.
I don't think it's Epic so much as the person who owns 40% of the company or 60% of the company.
Yeah.
Ah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have.
He's done some pretty mean tweets over the years about Linux. Linux.
Yeah. I have to say, I wasn't a big fan of Steam either, but when Linux support came in and more games came to Linux,
mm-hmm.
It really made my time in the system more and more, because I have dual boot system. I have Windows for stuff, for work and such things, and Linux for my free time and everything else, because I have everything smooth and fine and shiny for me there. That's just me, okay? That's
mm-hmm.
Everyone wants what should do but what
before
wants,
we answer Neith's question, this is one of the good things about Star Citizen using Vulkan. Vulkan's good. Vulkan's very much open and supported by everything, whereas DX12
is not.
You may not know this, but NVIDIA cards don't fully support DX12, really.
No, they
whereas
do not.
ATI, fucking hell, how old am I? AMD cards do fully support it, and Vulkan. And... Mm-hmm. Like, look at Red Dead Redemption 2. Everyone was like, I'm going to use DX12 on it, and so many fucking bugs came up, and NVIDIA cards switched to Vulkan. didn't, you know, it might not look quite good, or they might feel it's running a little bit shittier, but it fucking worked. And Vulcan, you know, I love Vulcan.
All the Stadia things, it's also Vulcan games, because coming from Linux servers, as far as I know it. And Steam made a thing, it's I think it's called Proton or something.
Yep.
With which you can play nearly everything. It's so amazing. I can game on Linux now, and no problems here.
Yep.
So
I think that was the one. I'm not sure if it was Proton or the one before it, but Epic bought out the company that were doing it and then said, no, you're going to stop doing that now.
What? Why? That's ridiculous.
Let's fight Epic.
Competition is good. The Unreal Engine is good. PC exclusives, fuck off. Don't tie me to one fucking launcher, because that's the only way you can get an edge in the market. No, it isn't good for me as a consumer. No, it isn't encouraging competition. It's just you being a complete person who's not very nice. It's not going to work. Don't fuck me around like that. I would rather not have the game at all than encourage a developer or publisher in this instance to go to your fucking store. That fuck right off. If you've made the game yourself, fine. Fair enough, you know, whatever. It's your game, it's your company, that's fair enough. But the third party tying me to a completely separate company's launcher just because the publisher wants that bit of extra money for guaranteed sales so you can fudge the fucking numbers that you've sold? Fuck off.
Agreed.
Ambulanger is bad.
Yeah, it would. I wouldn't have as much, although I still probably would have some problem with it. I wouldn't have as much of an issue with it if the actual launcher was getting better or was decent. But it's not.
The technology to get a shopping cart and a launcher is decades away.
Apparently. Also, reviews in a launcher. Also, purchasing multiple things at once.
You're never
going to
have reviews
gifting.
On Epic.
Apparently
never
not.
Gonna have reviews. Apparently having reviews from people is bad for gaming, according to certain someone.
What? Okay.
No forums either. And officially, you should use the Steam forums for Epic Games.
That's awesome.
You're only using the neat Steam forum. I will use Steam.
So I think we should talk about Neith's question here.
Yeah.
Neith asks. If you're in a group and you die and you spawn in a Cutlass Red, how do you get a ship back? I don't see the benefit. So, the reason you'd use a Cutlass Red for spawning is if you were doing some kind of ground action or you were a crew member aboard a ship that's in the fleet. So, this is not a spawn point you'd use if you wanted to fly a ship after you respawned. Although you could. You just have to ask the Cutlass guy to fly you to the nearest spot where you can spawn a ship. There are a bunch of those on the surface of the planets where you can spawn ships. But yeah, it's not like you can spawn a ship from the Cutlass Red. So
The other advantage of it is, like Tofu said, if you are doing an assault on the ground, you've got a mobile spawn point.
Yeah.
You could use it in eventually. This is obviously long term. You could use it as a fleet support. If you're in a massive fleet, one would assume the fleet has got some spare ships anyway. So you respawn on this Cutlass, and you've got to get your ass over to this other person's new ship to help out on there, so you can get back in the fight faster.
Very, very critical to this too is a ship like the Carrick having a med bed and a respawn point is critical, because the whole point of the Carrick is that you'll at least significant amount of the time be way out of contact with anything else, and you're going to have a crew on board, and you have a little a little ship on board too, so if you run into trouble out there and somebody dies, it's nice that they don't have to spawn back at like Port Olisar. know what I mean? Having them respawn on your ship is huge, I think. Same deal with the 890 jump. You know, one of your VIP guests slips and falls down the stairs. you can drag him to the med bed.
I was just recently looking a video from Morphologist, or what he's called. I don't know. I like his videos sometimes, most of the time.
I see the architect reviews guy.
Yeah, right, that guy.
Yeah.
He was making a mission with his friends and shot his one friend accidentally in the back. So he blamed the leg.
Accidentally.
Not accidentally. Real accidentally. He blamed the real leg accidentally. And everything else. But yeah. For him, the guy dead on the next planet respawn 1,000 kilometers away. So that's definitely a cutlass red moment here. So I see a lot of people getting used to it or will use it, and I hope that the rentals for the ship are also very, very low. So
I mean, it's also the start of the actual mechanic coming into game for when the game is released. You die, you know, planet X from outer space, and then you can respawn back in safer space, the equivalent of a Port Olisar, and you can spawn a new ship and go, well, fuck, I guess I've got to earn some more money.
Yes, very true. One thing I wanted to touch on, because it is, as much as people don't always love talking about it, I am the designated person to talk about it, and it's important. Funding for Star Citizen has kind of picked up where it left off at the end of last year, which was basically exploding. I'll put it this way. January, they've already made... We got, 6 days left in January? They've already made $4.2 million in January. And they're basically at, like... They're well above any other January ever in the history of Star Citizen. Almost above the totals for January and February for most years. So, this is not the part of the year where they usually make very much money. So, that's good. It'll definitely continue to help them hire more people for development. So, thumbs up. It also means that people are generally feeling positive about the game, so...
Yeah, so no major fuck-ups, the expected delays, people are used to it, and just happy with what we get.
The game's looking a lot better these days, too.
Confirmed, if there are any major fuck-ups or delays, it is now Tofu's fault.
Yes.
This is confirmed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We'll bring Tofu on to just be like, damn you, Tofu!
We'll just take videos of Tofu in various poses saying, I'm sorry.
And I just wanted to mention to people, I spent a couple hours this week doing sort of maintenance and fix-ups on the crowdfunding sheet. Extended a lot of the like calculations and graphs and stuff right through the end of 2021. So we got lots of runway for that spreadsheet to continue to record the history of this insane project. I'm actually kind of impressed. So I don't really think about it very much, but we're almost 8 years into this spreadsheet continually being updated. It's got a lot of data on it. And yeah.
Can I do a controversial thing?
Oh, no.
That I know a lot of people are going to hate, but I feel it needs to be asked. The Star Citizen Refunds Reddit was recently made private. I would like to ask the people who are running it to make it unprivate, because you offer a service, a great service, that if someone wants a refund and they're entitled to and don't know how to get it, they go to you.
Mm-hmm.
Please,
and now it's gone.
Let those people, you know, help those people out.
Mm-hmm.
I.
What happened? Do we know?
Don't know. Don't care. Don't get me wrong. It is their Reddit. If they don't want to make it public, that's their prerogative. But if anyone wants a refund and is entitled to it and doesn't know how to do it, they are the people to go to.
Who is entitled to a refund?
Someone who's bought the game within 14 days wants to change their mind.
Okay. Good to know. So.
And that link there. That link there is to the crowdfunding sheet if anybody has never seen it. I'm sure most or all of the people in here have seen it. But if you ever want to go poke around and see what the history of the crowdfunding looks like and how it's changing, because it really didn't change for a long time. It was the same pattern every year and roughly the same amount every year, and now it's changing quite drastically towards the better if you're CIG. Actually, I always argued more funding is, I mean, as long as people aren't being, like, forced into giving them money, more funding for the project is better for the players, too. You don't want them to have to suddenly release a game because they ran out of money. That's not a good thing.
But I don't want to, also don't want them to indefinitely continue.
True.
The development of Squadron 42.
No, yes, of course it needs to
Episode
come out,
one.
But I also don't really believe that they don't want to finish it, if you know what I mean. So I think overall it's a good thing. Also, for those who didn't know, I think I mentioned this last show, but on CIG's website, not Star Citizen's, so like the Cloud Imperium website, they did have the financial update as well for the company. They are continuing to be open about that, and thumbs up to them for that. That's awesome.
Definitely, transparency in every regard is. And at first, it's a little bit, how should I say it, for the people to get used to it, because it's always connected to a shitstorm, but in the end, I get it bears better results with everyone.
So as of the end of 2018, the company had $53 million in the bank. Not a bad position to be in. And of course, in 2019, they had their best funding year to date, so they are probably in a fairly good position going forward. Do we have any more questions here? I don't see any more questions. We need more questions. Please question us. Grill us. Question us. Ask us riddles and rhymes and limericks.
Why shouldn't you trust a big cat in Africa?
Because they'll eat you.
Because they're always lying.
Except they're not always lying. Sometimes they're cheetah.
Well, you shouldn't trust them either.
Lions and cheetahs. Terrible.
Sorry, Miami.
We got Miami. Oh, it was
I'll
so
go back
good.
To posting memes for
oh,
you.
Oh, man. That's awesome. Oh, and the other thing I wanted to mention, I can't believe I didn't mention this when we were talking about the Lunar New Year sale, but as you may have noted, may have realized, not only is the Cutlass Red in the game, but it is for sale as well. They have a bunch of options on the website, obviously the standard Warbond and non-Warbond options, and a whole bunch of various packs if you want, like, a whole Drake fleet.
Okay.
Which, you know, some people definitely would want.
What is the cheapest red and what is the most expensive red?
So the Warbond is $120 US and the non-Warbond is $135. And then there's game packs that have, like, multiple ships from $190 through to $725. Yeah. You can get, actually, that's not a terrible deal. You can get a Cutlass Red and a Cutlass Black for $190 US.
Bum, 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 bum. I stay with my Reliant Core.
But I will remind everybody, as we always do. Shiver usually gives this reminder, but I'm going to give this reminder now. There's no need to buy more ships. You can buy more ships if you want to buy more ships, if you want to support the project. But that's, there's no need to buy them to play the game. The game comes with even an Aurora package or a Mustang package. Or I still think they have the new package with what is it called? The Expedition one.
I thought that was discontinued.
I think it went away. I think it went away with I think it went away with the IAE thing. But that was a pretty cool package too.
Am I really the one who says that? Oh God, I'm such a cynical asshole. I'm sorry.
What?
Really the one who says don't spend any more money? I'm sorry.
No, you're just usually the person. I mean, it's a good reminder, and I just realized you're usually the person who reminds people that you don't have to spend more money.
I will invest in a new PC soon, so ooh. I have no money for shipping.
Oh,
thank you for giving us a topic. What is your build going to be? Put you on the spot.
I think 3990X.
Oh my God!
Nice.
I want to see this computer when it's done.
Nice.
I need some tower. A good one.
Get a dank really base one. 900.
What?
A dank or dark base dark. 900.
Okay.
I thought that actually said dank for a second when he said that.
No, that was a Canadian syrup thing. He thought it said dank, and I'm like, yeah, I'm going to call it the dank base now.
All right, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah.
So 3990.
Yeah, the fastest RAM.
Mm-hmm.
I think 64 gigabytes should be enough.
Yeah, it should be about right. For a computer with that much processor, yeah.
Yeah. The graphics card will be my actual graphic card is a 1070 Ti.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning and the drives I will also collect, but take the same drives. Maybe one SSD, M.2 SSD. I want to have.
Mm-hmm.
So it should be. I hope I get under 1,500 with just those components with motherboard. Motherboard 3990X and tower plus
RAM
and. What's it called? Power.
The power supply. Power supply unit.
Yeah. Do I get that under 1,500?
That's the towers. It depends on the tower you're going to get and the RAM, I'd say.
Yeah. Actually, what?
The cost of towers now. Jesus Christ.
How much is the 3990X?
Actually, I want a good tower which has what's it called? Dam filter?
Noise filter, noise dampening.
Not noise dampening. The fuzzy stuff in the air. What is it called?
Are you? You're getting the 64 core Threadripper 3990X?
No.
Because it's like $4,000.
Not the Threadripper.
No. The 3950X.
3950X. Sorry.
Ah, okay, that makes more sense. I was like, how are you going to get this thing under...
Say dust filters.
750 dust filter. Oh, there it is.
Yeah,
thanks.
Dank Base Pro has them built in.
Yeah.
And noise dampening.
Nice. Okay. Nice.
And you a Qi charger built in.
A Qi charger. Nice. Everyone needs to recharge their Qi from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
Shivers just nodding.
So,
I fucking love this case.
Pretty amazing. I want dust filters.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Because if I buy a fucking expensive CPU, then I want it down to dust up.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I would imagine you can with a 3950X, you can definitely put that all together. I think for 1,500 euros. I would imagine.
As far as I know, oh, fuck me. I can't even pronounce your name, so I probably got Qi charger totally off, but... If you want to cut down on how much dust is coming into your PC, if you can, get a passive cooler. But then you've got to be really clever about how you've set your thing up, because that's what I'm using. But then I'm only pushing a 6700K.
I was so impressed that Shiver has a fully passive cooler on his CPU. I actually did like a triple take when I looked at it and like, what the? There's no fans on that thing.
Passive cooling has been my thing since 15 years now. I've been doing it.
Oh my god, that's
because I had a CPU cooler that just died on me, and I was like, yeah, I'm not gonna go through that again.
Well, I'm impressed. Passive cooling is hard to pull off, but you do a good job. So. The blocks are impressively enormous too, just huge.
Yeah, that I can imagine.
Oh man!
I mean, the advantage of doing it is, it's compatible with almost any CPU because it's a block of fucking metal.
Yep. Yeah, there isn't a lot of compatibility problem there. As long as the interface is about the same.
Mm.
You have to screw it on the board, and all the metal has to stay in one spot.
That is true.
You will slice your fucking fingers up placing it down and go, ah! it's a mark that you've done it right when your CPU cooler has your blood on it.
Yeah, right. Personalize my computer that way I ever dreamt of. Yeah.
Oh, water cooling loop is gorgeous, but too complicated for me.
The blood does help it stay cool, yes.
I talked about water cooling, but rumor has it that water pumps are louder than fans nowadays. And I have a Noctua fan in my actual...
Noctua.
And I don't hear a fucking thing. It's amazing.
Noctua is amazing.
Anything. So the only thing I hear is when my graphics card ramps up. Then I hear really noise. But Noctua fans...
Hey, Noctua. Can you please give me a sponsorship?
Yeah.
I'm using Noctua fans too.
Noctua everywhere.
That is the choice you make. Is do you go for performance, which is going to basically mean noise, or not? You know, silence.
Mm-hmm.
If I have a powerful CPU, I go for performance by just throwing money at it at some degree.
I mean, like, the way I've got mine set up is because it's passive. If the PC is just sat there doing nothing, the fans don't really rear up. They're going about 300 RPM. When it's doing something with that fucking amazing Noctua fan on it, it can go up to 3000 RPM, and you do hear it, but then you're playing a game, so you should be listening to the game, not your fans screaming at you.
I did want to mention, for those who are curious, those who are looking to build new computers this year, we are expecting a new raft of graphics cards to come along, including Big Navi and probably some sort of response to Big Navi by NVIDIA. So, good news again.
Navi is the Intel thing?
No, Navi is... we're going to ignore the Intel thing. Navi is the... so the 5700 XT and the 5600 XT, those cards from AMD are on are Navi cards. And so it's 7-nanometer process. But the 5700 XT is a pretty good card, but it's actually way cut down from what they could make with that. So Big Navi is the full size GPU.
It's up to Lisa Su announced we're going to see Big Navi this year,
yes.
And then the week after, the NVIDIA 3080 and NVIDIA 3070 specs were leaked. Coincidence?
Yeah.
Oh, not coincidence at all.
Truck has asked us a question.
Oh my god, we got a question? Oh my god. All right. Mud Trucka asks, what gameplay can you imagine to see when Pyro is first added to the game? Can I answer this? Getting shot a lot. Pyro is a lawless system. It's not a part of the UEE, so getting shot a lot is the answer to what gameplay you're going to see in Pyro.
That means that the reputation system has quite made come long until then, because you need some reputation to go there.
One of the nice things about Pyro, and what I've actually been saying, I was so happy. I was actually right. I've been thinking that Pyro was going to be the first system added after Stanton for like 5 years now. And I was right. And part of the reason for it is it's actually really, it should be pretty easy for them to make. There isn't a whole lot of stuff in Pyro. It's basically a huge wasteland, a pirate wasteland. And Ruin Station is the like big location there, but it's a space station, so there isn't a ton for them to build for Pyro. So I think they'll be able to pump out Pyro pretty quickly and then go into a third system.
What about like jump point mechanics and things like that?
In terms of gameplay, yeah. I expect that will all be in there. So finding jump points, navigating jump points. And again, like all gameplay with Star Citizen, it might be like a version 1 sort of, or V0 of those aspects, but we should at least see them. I'm hoping that we get some more, along with the Carrick and with Pyro and everything, I'm hoping we get some more exploration type mechanics. That would be cool. And hopefully there's some things to find in Pyro where it's dangerous.
We've got another question.
I just want into the anal thing.
I know. You just want to fly into the anus. I understand. Ashley asks, why do you think it is that we don't have more generalist ships that you can fly solo or multi-crew like the Cuddy or Freelancer? Why are there not more generalist ships, either solo or small multi-crew?
It's easier to balance, meta-wise, I suppose. It's easier to balance if you've got specific ships with specific roles.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a good thing to ask about multi-crew. It's a long time we really talked about it.
Mm-hmm.
How far has it come?
Oh, that's a good point, yeah. I mean, they're, it's coming, but it's slow.
Yeah, it's very slow. And you need to find, actually, some balance in that.
Yeah, totally. I think the Constellation is also a very generalist type of ship. It can kind of do anything.
But the thing with general ships is, jack of all trades, master of none.
Mm-hmm. That's not a bad thing, though. No, I like having a ship that I can do all sorts of things with.
Everyone with a specialized acting ship can blow you up.
You could use the Carrick in PvP. You're probably a bit mad to do it, but it could do it. But it's not going to excel at that because it's not its role. But I suppose it's just, general ships are also quite hard to do in a gameplay and balance-wise. Maybe they're not as popular for sale. It just seems that once you get into a certain gameplay route yourself, look at Eve as well. Eve does the same with their tier 2 ships. They're very specialized, like the tier 1 frigates, you could fit them up to do virtually anything, but they don't excel at it. But the tier 2 frigates are they're a combat orientated ship.
Mm-hmm. That's fair.
No, you cannot fly the Connie. Well, the Connie is meant to be multi-crew, isn't it? But you're going to eventually be able to have NPC crew.
All right. So I think that's it for the show today. Unless we have another question, which we don't. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. And hopefully everything is better over at the Eris household next week and he can join us again.
Did you just call Eris an Eris hole?
Yes, I did. Actually,
I love that.
I actually didn't, but okay. I'll go with that. Jake is currently moving, so his life is, you know, a catastrophe, as I'm sure we've all experienced in the recent past.
Ooh, I'm moving next week.
Hey, you're moving too? Yeah. Everyone's moving. Yeah. So Jake will be back in February, once he's settled into his new place and into his new internet, which we're all excited for because he'll be able to do more stuff and stream and things, from his new house. And, yeah, I hope you all have an awesome weekend and thank you for joining us. As SpaceX launches come up, I will try and stream them. The next one is unfortunately going to be too early in the day on a weekday for me to be able to do it. It'll be during work, so. But it looks like it's probably going to be Tuesday-ish. Next Starlink launch. So, yeah. All right, have a good weekend, everybody. Thank you very much for watching. And see you next weekend. Same place, same time.